guys are beautiful. What you doing back there? What you're doing is just beautiful. That's great. Huh? What happened?
Yeah, she's, Mama wants you to take your coat off.
I don't know what Mom wants.
Come on. You want to leave it on?
Yeah.
No, he wants to leave it on. But anyway,
come on.
Flowers.
Oh,
that's nice. Back there.
Beautiful.
Welcome to our house.
Thank you very much.
Yeah. You want to play some more?
Good. You want to hear one more?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah. Thank you. Wow. Of course. Sure.
William Bill Basie werd op 21 augustus 1904 in Red Bank, New Jersey geboren. Hij kreeg op jeugdige leeftijd pianolessen van zijn moeder en speelde in het begin van de 20e jaren bij een rondreizende revue als pianist. In 1927 ging deze revue in Kansas City failliet en Basie kwam zonder werk te zitten. Via een baantje als theaterorganist kwam hij terecht bij de band van Walter Page, de Blue Devils. En in 1929 bij Benny Moten's Kansas City Orchestra, waar hij tot 1935 speelde, het jaar van Moten's overlijden.
Set the tempos, I mean, and he had his little easy way of doing it in this band. When he make an introduction and he opened up a door as wide as a house for you. I mean, all you had to do was just get in there. First of all, in jazz music, it's a feeling about the music that really makes it what jazz is all about. And Basie has that.
Basie knows time and temper, and that's what he's striving on. Time and tempo, you know, just what tempo to put a number, and he works on that. That's one of the secrets.
Basie is a Leo, and that's the lion. You know, the lion is the lion. If you look at a real lion, when this lion is eaten and feel comfortable, I mean, you know, birds can pick all over him, and he look at you, you know, and there's no excitement there. But he's aware of everything.
I first got to know Basie when he was at the Lafayette Theater in 1931 with Benny Moten's band. Luckily, I used to hang out at the Speakeasy, which was right behind the stage door of the Lafayette, which was called Covan's Morocco Club. And they had a beat-up old piano there, which Garland Wilson used to play. And between shows, Basie would hang out at the Morocco Club and have a taste, which is what it was called, of alcohol. And then he would play the piano. that's the first time I really got to know Basie in the flesh. And he was Bill Basie.
When Basie joined Benny Moten, I think that he and Eddie Durham made the band a little bit more modern than they had been, because I had been listening to Benny Moten ever since I was in school, when I was about 12, 13. And they still had that kind of old style, which was in style at that time. But Basie came along, and with Eddie, they made some, they had new ideas for the band.
See, Benny Moten wasn't polished too well with that modern style. He had some kind of old style he liked. Kansas City, the musicians there had some sort of a style that wasn't any place. I was discussing it with Hal Sanger the other night, and that's where it was, but out that way, those musicians still had a style.
Right.
It was established right in Kansas City. A lot of them say New Orleans, a lot of them say a lot of other places, but Kansas City is where it was. But a lot of guys come from Texas, New Orleans, and they settled right there, and that's where the battle started. See, we couldn't change the band with just ideas. We had to change men to get some of the ideas we wanted, and that's how they started putting in different guys. And that's one thing helped, because some of the guys you couldn't change, as I first said, you make arrangements, it's gonna sound just like Benny Moten. I don't care what you add, they had their way of playing it. You could interpret to them. See? Benny Moten was an excellent piano player. And his nephew was an assistant piano player. And Basie came in the band, and he wanted to play piano. So we had three piano players. So we were walking down the street one day, and we saw an accordion. And Basie said, "Let's get that accordion for Bus." And that's how Bus got on the accordion. But I just found out it was Basie's idea to get on the piano.
Sounds good.
Sounds good. Yeah, and I was thinking of that the other day.
Cabs, because the man had put us out of the hotel. I said, "Don't worry about it. He said, I said, what you want to do? He said, man, I'd like to go to New York. I'd like to go to Atlantic City. I said, you can't. So we used to buy a newspaper. And wherever it said Duke Ellington, Jimmy Nelson, or Cab Calloway, we'd put our hand on it and say, Count Basie's appearing here. We ain't getting nowhere. But we had a dream.
Black bands at that time, you know, particularly in white spots. And we just had to build a completely new market for Basie. But there were interesting ways of doing this, because we opened Basie's band in Roseland Ballroom in November, I think it was, of 1936. And that was successful. He was playing opposite Woody Herman, and he wiped out Woody Herman every night, I would say.
Benny Moten used to say, you know, I don't know, this guy ain't no count. Basie was a jab artist, I would say. So I wrote a song called The Count. But to the men, that would meant no count. And when Benny would call the number, all the band would laugh. And Basie didn't know what they laughed about.
I don't know if Buck was there or not.
And that's how he got his name, Count.
I went into Kansas City. I was in Kansas City for 6 weeks. I only played drums twice. I was trying to play piano then, you know. And I was playing with Tommy Douglas' band at the Cherry Blossoms. And Walter Page says, how would you like to join Basie's band? I said, no way. I ain't ready yet. So nothing was happening to do. We went to Topeka, Kansas. And I'm sitting up in the bass band. I'm doing All Blight with Hot Lips Page and Lester Young. I'm doing All Right until they played After You're Gone. Lester Young played one course. Then he stood up and took the second course. I started to jump out the window. They had to find me to pay me off. So when they did find me and took me back to Kansas City, I said, Mr. Basie, you got a nice band. I hope you go far. I am going back to Omaha, and I'm going to go back to school. Goodbye. You can't. I said, I'm gone. Well, I don't see Mr. Basie no more at all. I'm in Minneapolis, and I don't like it. So I came back into Kansas City. No band, no job, no money. So we decided to organize. We got Hot Lips Page, Buster Smith, Walter Page, bass, and myself. We worked for Chief Ellis Brayton. We worked for $1.50 a night, 2 free beers, spaghetti, and meatballs.
I just left Shanghai, and I was making about $200 a week over there at that time. I come back to California, I was making about $100. I go to Kansas City, and I joined Basie, and my salary went down to $14 a week, $2 a night. 7 nights from 10 till about 3 or 4 in the morning. And even then, the guy, after Lips had left, you remember Saul?
Yeah.
Basie says, Saul, I got a new trumpet player. I'd like to put him in Lips' place. Saul says, no, I can't stand that. Now, I said, Lips is gone. That's $2 less I have to pay, so I can't put it up anymore. So the guys in the band were making $2.25 a night. So they all chipped in their quarter. That made me get $2 a night. So that's where I joined count, $14 a week.
Basic rhythm section, 2 things, spiritually and mentally. Now, that's the only explanation I know. It was there, it will always be there. And as long as Freddie Green is with Count Basie, you're gonna hear it. Because Freddie's playing for Walter Page and Freddie's playing for me, along with Basie. So that's it. It's a tripod. Freddie Green, bass, and myself. But right over there is Walter Page. When you see Freddie Green, bass, and myself together, don't nobody come around, because Walter Page is right there. Walter Page was my father. Walter Page was my son. Without Mr. Walter Page, you would never have heard about Hot Lips, Jimmy Rushing, Count Basie.
The only time there was ever even a problem in our relationship with Basie was when it was decided for him that he would go to Victor. He had been with Columbia for a long time, and I was trying to get him for a label that I was with, and it didn't come through, unfortunately. It would have been much better for Basie if it had gone through, because his experience with Victor was so disastrous that that's when he had to give up his big band and have the small band with Buddy DeFranco. Luckily, that only lasted a couple of years.
Came in when Basie had a small band. He had four horns and rhythm section. Three horns and rhythm section. Three. And as Wardell Gray was playing tenor saxophone and Clark Terry was playing trumpet, and I replaced Buddy DeFranco, the clarinet player. Thank you.
Basie's band as a clarinet player. And I just, I always kept my saxophone with me because I've been a lead alto player all my life, one way or the other. And we travel around for a while, playing clubs, etc. And I think around the spring of 1951, I think Willard Alexander and a few people talked him back into getting a large orchestra. We went through that, and I sort of helped him to organize the thing. I was his, you can call it a music director, so I'm the guy that rehearsed the band and helped in any manner possible to make his band a playing success. I thought it was an excellent band. I think it's one of the best bands anybody ever had, Basie's band of the 50s.
Compare the two bands from the different eras, it wasn't at all the same feeling in that most of the guys in the early Basie's band, they had made names for themselves, and they were, some of them were, you know, they were on a star status. But in the 50s band, it was like we were all more or less starting from scratch again, you know. And Basie being a very wise band lead, I mean, the way I saw it, he let us have the feeling as though like it was our band in a way, because it which gave us a certain pride. And this pride built up into a great family, a great relationship among all of us. And I think that was one of the big points that I remember about this last band. We seemed to do everything more or less together, and we worked for each other. It wasn't so much we all wanted some recognition, of course, and but I think it was the team work together that really made that band outstanding, and it made everybody wanted to work in there to make it good.
My man don't love me. treats me awful mean. He's the lowest man that I've ever seen.
Because we used to play tonk back there, you know.
What was that?
Tonk. It was a game that you play with the cards. It's a kind of a rummy game. Well, you know, you don't use as many cards with it. But it was a very popular game among traveling musicians at the time.
I remember Al Killian one time saved up to about $1,700 before he got to Birmingham as a rated home. The night before we got to Birmingham, he had his money and he's glad he's going to see his mother. And prayers got him into a crap game because we'd all be asleep on the bus. And prayers would get these two two dice. And they roll it up in there, and you hear these, everybody's sleeping, you hear two dice. Prez would say, sweet music, sweet music. So we'd go back in the bus and shoot craps for about 10 hours. And Al Killian lost his $1,700 just before we got to Birmingham. That morning, we got in Birmingham about 10 o'clock. At 9 o'clock, he lost his last dollar.
You keep your New York yard. I'm going to Illinois just as fast as I can. So you New York women think you make a fool of any man. You play all kinds of games. You will cheat if you can. You love like a tool and make a man a fool, but a beautiful motto. I've got my money, that's it. How can you mind if I split the table? Going back where a woman really knows the way to treat a man. People are friendly with no hidden plan. It's the best in the Midwest. It's a real down city full of good folks who go. from home. And when I get back, I'll never roam far from my little shy town. Goodbye, farewell, I might see you later. Going to Chicago. Sorry that I can't take you. I come from Chi-Town and that is my town. Going to Chicago. Sorry that I can't take you. I got to quit you, can't make it with you. There's nothing in Chicago that a monkey woman can do. Out of your line, baby, quit your crying. When you see me coming, baby, raise your window high. Your window to the sky. Yeah. When you see me coming, baby, raise your window high. Me passing on the line. See me passing, baby. Hang your head and cry your soul and wonder why. Yeah. Hurry down, sunshine.
Come on in a hurry.
See what tomorrow brings.
Tomorrow. At tomorrow.
What tomorrow brings.
Tomorrow. And tomorrow.
And the sun went down, baby.
What happened
to you? Tomorrow brought a rain.
Tomorrow.
What happened?
A brought sorrow.
Anybody ask you, baby? Who was it sang this song? Anybody ask you, baby, who was it sang this song? Jimmy Rogers and Joe. Well, we've been there and gone.
I wanted to go in were Charlie Ventura, and had a possibility because Benny Green was leaving. Illinois Jacket, as Henry Coker, I believe, had told me about. But I worked at the Apollo Theater with Joe Thomas's big band. It was a band that was just gotten together for a week. In this band was Charlie Folks. While we worked this week, he told me that Basie was putting together another big band and asked if I would like to come and audition for it. Anyway, we had what I thought was a nice rehearsal, but I don't know, you're so excited about this being Count Basie and all of that until it's almost like another, for me, it was another time zone. I was almost out of myself, and really, in retrospect now, I can look back on it, but while it was happening, it was like fantastic. I didn't believe I was rehearsing with Count Basie's band. But by now, I want to know whether I'm with the band or not, whether I have a job so I can cut loose all of this Charlie Ventura and the rest of this. So I asked Basie. I was so afraid of him, naturally. He's Count Basie and I'm little Benny Powell from New Orleans. So I didn't know how to exactly say, Count Basie, do I have a job? So I think I kind of eased next to him and said, trombone section sound all right? Or something like that, you know. I'm expecting him to say, yeah, it's fine, you got a job. So finally I said, well, am I with the band? He said, you're here, aren't you, kid?
I was in the Army in Korea in early 1952, and somebody brought a copy of Downbeat magazine to the place where I was stationed, and in it was an article on Count Basie with pictures of Lockjaw and Paul Quinichet. You may remember this article. And I remember reading the article and saying, boy, how I would love to be with that band. Not knowing that about 6 months later, I was to be with the very same band, because when I got discharged in May of that year, I was just walking down the street in Detroit, Michigan. I ran into a hometown buddy of mine who said, hey, man, Count Basie's looking for you. Just like that. And I said, oh, yeah? Said, I'm looking for him, too. Where is he? Take me to him. Take me to my leader.
Well, I really wasn't interested in the road anymore. But what he said that made me join the band, made me accept his offer, was that he said, well, look, I can give you more exposure than you've had, you know. So I started thinking about that. I said, yeah, well, maybe that's, you know, maybe that's what it is, you know. And then I said, well, look, I got to have a salary, because I never went to nobody without a salary. I went in 46 with Bill Eckstein. I was on salary all the time, you know. So he said, OK, you know, we got together and salary, and OK. So I was on salary for 11 years with Basie, you know, whether I worked or not. You know, that's the only way I would leave. But actually, I had given up on the road by the time I went with Basie.
When I asked him about my salary, and I was just so much in awe of this man. If he looked at me, I was like a teenage girl looking at Elvis Presley. You know, it's like, he said, how you doing, kid? And I trembled. I think he must have thought that I didn't like him because I was too choked up to speak to him. But anyway, when I finally got my courage up and asked him, Mr. Basie, what about my salary? He said, oh, we'll take care of you, kid. And that's the, that was the end of that.
You got one of those, too.
We had played Atlanta, and after the gig that night, I was up to Red's Club. We was at club upstairs there from the hotel, Peacock, you know, or whatever. Anyway, I was up there, and I was drinking, you know, and I was feeling pretty good. I was about drunk. And Basie had seen me up there, you know. So when I got back to the hotel, Papa Jack came up and said, Chief wants to see you. I said, OK. So I'm stoned, you know. I go back and go to his room. Said, yeah, Cap, you want to see me? He said, yeah. And he goes through his thing, and he's telling me how much, how hard it is for him to keep the band together, and how much he had to go in debt to reform the band, and, you know, and all the humiliation that he's gonna have to go through, but he's just gonna have to live it down and get his things back together and everything, and how the transportation was eating him up, and all of this. He just, you know, he told me everything he could think of. But, you know, like, I know, you know, I've been through all this before, so I didn't say anything, you know? I didn't say yes, I didn't say no, I didn't nod yes, I didn't nod no, I just sat up and looked at him. And he talked, and then he'd start back through his story again, and I still didn't say anything. And about the third time around, you know, I said, hey, Bass, you know what? I was just thinking, why you ever hired Jimmy Rushing to sing the blues the way you can cry? He said, well, you always got your horn tuned up. And that was the end of that, and he never bothered me anymore. He never bothered me anymore about my salary. The thing is, you had to know how to talk to Basie, you know, because as long as you are around him any kind of way, you've always got some mind game going on with him, everybody.
Yeah. Oh, yeah.
He's got a mind game going on with everybody in the band. And he's always got something going with you, and you got to stay on your toes. If you don't, you know, you ain't going to make it. You couldn't just go to Basie and say, I want a raise, you know, because it's, you know.
It wasn't like that. It wasn't that easy.
It ain't like that. You know, you can't do that. See, like, if I wanted some more money, I'd go to Basie. You know, I say, you know what, Basie? I need a job, you know? What do you mean you need a job? I say, because this one ain't working out right. You know what I mean? So automatically, he knows by that he's got to give me some more money or I'm gone. You know what I mean? So that's what, you know, you can't just come and say, give me some money, you know.
Thank you.
Basie, when he did point out things that weren't quite right, he would do it. You have to remember that. I think the key word for me that goes along with Basie is subtle. And he was subtle about everything. He would never say to you that this is wrong or this has got to be played faster or shorter, or he would always do something to indicate that the way you were doing it wasn't quite the way he had in mind. Never did you do anything wrong. That was always nice. You always did it another way. And it was an incredibly subtle way of helping you to understand the way he wanted it. If after a few hints you still didn't get it, then other steps had to be taken, sometimes just coming right out and almost coming right out and saying, you know, let's get in there, let's do it this way. But almost never did that happen.
We're not working as hard as we have been working mm-hmm. in the past years before things start happening to me. I start falling apart. But we're going to cut away. We've been doing like 100%. Now we'll probably be doing like 70-30 or something like that.
Oh, yeah.
Or maybe a lot lesser than that.
Yeah.
And so there we go.
What's happening? How did you two meet? I meant to ask you that for quite some time.
With who? Katie and I?
Yes.
Your mom?
Yeah.
That's none of your business.
See. I mean, keep it clean.
Well, now it's always got to be clean, but the only thing, well, that's something that even you're not going to know anything about it until you read it.
Oh.
Because we're writing it.
Oh, so you've got a book in the process.
That's right. Yeah, that's the only reason I'll have to tell you in a minute, you know.
Oh, good. I'll buy the first copy.
No, the first copy you have already.
Oh,
you'll have
nice.
It.
Nice. Mrs. Basie, do you find yourself...
What did you say? No. Say Mom. Nothing.
Do you find yourself on the road full time now?
Yes.
Yeah?
I have to come take care of the daddy. He's been taking care of me for about 39 years, and now I come out to take care of him.
Do you think that there'll be any new projects coming out musically? For you and for the band, do you have anything in mind that you're thinking about, that you're working on, that I can look forward to?
Well, you can look forward to a couple of things which I wouldn't like to mention right now because I don't know, you might be thinking about that pretty hard. Mm-hmm. And then I don't know just about how that's going to work out. I got to give that some more thought, you know.
Oh yeah.
I've got to sleep a little bit on that some
okay.
more. See.
Yeah.
But it's a lot of things like you know, like the things that you do, mm-hmm. like where you are now. I mean, you did quite a bit of sleeping on this, you know. You see?
Yeah.
See, but I knew you were sleeping on something, you know. And then of course I used to say, "What are you thinking about now?" He said, "Well, nothing. I mean, so but right on."
Yeah.
Well, yeah. Of course, you got to think about a few things. Yeah. A lot of things that are new and going to be a little different, you know. But just about the same thing, but quite a little different, a little flavor.
Mm-hmm.
You know, there's always got to be something a little different because everything seems to be catching up a little bit of what's been happening.
See? Right, right.
So there's got to be another little different little taste for it to look forward to, eh?
You do not have the microphone up. It's down. If it's 5,000 people out there, you can feel it and you can hear it.
He was as great a pianist as there ever was. He knew when to play and when not to play. Basically just had all the instincts of a great leader right from the very beginning.
We got along very well. He's an easy man to work with, he's a nice man, and he's a considerate man.
I had great respect for him. And nothing bad I can say about him. But he's, you know, a nice leader, he was a real nice leader.
Really, I learned a lot of things from Basie. A lot of things that you don't even know you're learning till years later.
The way that he appears on stage is the way that he really is. People would often ask me, what's Basie really like? Yeah. And I'd have to tell them, the way you see him on stage, it's the way he is.
That's him.
With the smile and with the, you know, with the wink and with the nod.
I pretty much think it'll just go into history because the little man that sat at the piano had a particular style and touch. And even when anyone else as accomplished as Nat Pierce or Hank Jones would come and sit in, it wouldn't even be the same with the Basie band.
See, the only thing that kept Basie's band together was a little simple word called capital L-O-V-E. There has never been one before or since.